That is the sort of society that my colleagues and I will be working hard to build in the next few years. It is the most immense privilege to have that opportunity. I promise you, we will use it well and not waste it. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Well, there are certainly parallels with John Major's victory in 1992. That too came as a surprise to the pollsters. The phenomenon then was known as shy Tories, people who didn't want to share their voting preference. But that happened this time. Some suggested that there was a last-minute swing then with voters who didn't see the Labour leader as a credible Prime Minister. Again, there may be parallels in 2015. So John Major won an overall majority. That presented its own difficulties, and he found himself confronted by rebellious backbenchers again and again. So could that happen now? The David Cameron overall majority is the victory.
I actually convinced that all my colleagues will come back and report to the Whips Office that the number one issue on the doorsteps is immigration, something outside London.
Has David Cameron said enough on it?
We had given clear installed 3 months ago. And you very quickly get used
to
what is the new reality,
new government?
And you forget actually what rubbish you had before. It works every day, and I get top rated broadband, and I just use it all the time. So, in that sense, it's been a complete difference to my lives. One of the big advantages is that
another backbencher, Christopher Trent, after 2010, he told me that he kept
really
the manifesto
to get any kind of signal
and would occasionally
essentially outside of my study. And
he
now,
my
daughter's doing her A-levels, and she
may
not be getting the best wife, so to speak. You know, the phone line was fine. It worked all the time. As broadband as a for the phone now goes through the internet cable, so to speak. You know, the phone line was fine. It worked all the time. It was
those were things that the Liberal Democrats were insisting on before, and now we no longer have to count out the Liberal Democrats in a coalition government. I hope that the Conservative Party will listen to the views of its backbenchers.
So that was Christopher Choate with Becky Milligan reporting. So what will a Conservative majority, what will a Cameron Conservative majority government be like? At his acceptance speech in Oxfordshire last night, the Prime Minister resurrected a phrase of past conservatism hijacked by Labour in recent years.
Above all, I...
with the responsibility of leading the country for the next 5 years.
How easy will it be for him to achieve that agenda? Because in a sense, wasn't party management, you will know this very well as a chief whip, that with coalition with the Liberal group and backbenchers on the right, as David Cameron faced when he had an overall majority, do you worry about that kind of party management?
Funnily enough, in a way, because of the exigencies of coalition, and we needed to go into coalition, we didn't have a majority, and the coalition achieved a great deal. But the existence of coalition also meant that there were some backbenchers who felt that they had greater license not to support a coalition commitment if it hadn't actually been in the Conservative manifesto. I think that with a majority Conservative government, what we'll see, and it was already implicit in the helpful comments that Becky Milligan had generated from a number of my colleagues, it was already implicit that backbenchers want to support the government, wants
but
to show a great degree of solidarity.
Well, when it comes to some issues and Europe.
I wish I could take it back. I don't think it's in the
Do you want
this one? Right, can I just say before we start, we've got a young lady here. She's doing some recording in the white here, and she's doing it for a course she's doing. Okay.
Right.
If anybody objects to it, she's willing to.
One check!
Oh,
Well, Patrick Fadden is a former Shadow Business Secretary, a former political secretary to Tony Blair, and still the Labour MP for Wolverhampton. And so you heard the thoughts of Paul Kenny there. What do you think of Wolverhampton?
Well, it's a very different one. We've obviously had a terrible result from the Labour Party. But I think we've got a good
Is it just about Scotland?
No, it's not just about Scotland.
Okay, everybody, let's crack on.
And Scotland, obviously, a huge call of guilt. Very strong there, but I think it's just about Scotland. The truth is that in the vital Labour Tory margin, which decides on who gets the government, we made virtually go in. We won one or two spots at most of the targets. So I don't think it would be the right analysis to that.
Now, one of Ed Miliband's key positions was that he defined himself in a way by being not New Labour. Was that a mistake in your view?
Well, you can only say that we moved away from New Labour somewhat. And you're right, the one thing Ed Miliband was clear about was that he would be cutting the cage on the moving away from that, even more emphatically than Scott Brown. And we've seen the electoral response in the results last night, where we reduced to the number of MPs we had. So, I think in saying that, that doesn't mean we should try and find a rewind button to take us back to the future, because we're in different circumstances. But I do think we could have defended the record of our government more, a great deal of achievement. And I do think that it's quite a fundamental and far-reaching rebuilding project. We don't just need a new person at the top of the Labour Party. We need a new argument.
And what should that new argument be?
Well, we've got to look at where we succeeded and where we failed. We will always be the party of the lower grades. We will always be the party of people struggling for work. We'll always be the party of the NHS. So we need to be more than that too. We need to be the party of the middle income. We need to be the party of the aspirational family who do well. We need to be the party of all the itself. We need to make sure that we treat the creation of wealth and importantly as a fair distribution. If you only care about the creation of wealth, you won't have a good society. But if you only care about the fair distribution, you won't have the enterprise, growth driving, productivity policy that the country needs. So I think we need to match these two things.
But of course, Paul Kenny's argument was that actually it was the sort of traditional working class voters that have been left behind, and some of them perhaps turned to UKIP, that the party should be reaching out to.
Well, there is a sense of loss in some parts of the country, but it's like this. We should be about giving people a chance, not a reason. And I think that's the right leadership we want to be. To the very reason that we want to be, that Paul Kenny is right there.
Come on. It did come down and ask about it, and I'll sit on it. Sure, I'll give you two out. Do you want a pen as well?
Do an art piece.
Come on, do it.
Not quite sure what it's
going to be. Okay. Okay. It's to be on the second best building in Croughton after the church, isn't it? A lovely building. And the history of Edward Ramsay giving it to the village. You've been in the church.
I haven't
been to go in there. Got the painters, go up the bell tower.
Andrew!
Yes?
TV at Curry's BC World. Get up to four times the picture quality is full HD.
See clear from space. Fabulous detail.
4K has a greater depth of image. So it's life like a coral reef. A world as sharp as a great white's teeth. Wayne here is a freestyle precursor and a Vodafone SIM only customer. It's perfectly Wayne likes to do the same thing with his own phone. £9.50 a month. And we uphold him completely. What Wayne might not know is after just 3 months, he has the freedom to change his phone and upgrade to a brand new phone. Wayne doesn't think he's going to be able to do it. But after all, he's going to be able to do it.
RAF Croughton, one of America's military bases in Britain. It is a direct cable link to GCHQ, Britain's government communications headquarters, a direct fibre optic link to US camps in Africa, where drone strikes are launched, and it's about to become one of the largest intelligence hubs outside the mainland United States.
Mohammed Touan was 13 when he was given a camera to record his family life in Marib province in northern Yemen last year. Everything you see was filmed by Mohammed and his younger brother. In October 2011, Mohammed's father Saleh and 17-year-old brother Jilal were killed in a drone strike, leaving Mohammed and his brothers to care for their 27 siblings. US drones continued to patrol the skies over Marib, with two more attacks in the week that followed. The family has again received no explanation for Mohammed's death from either the US or Yemeni government. Al-Qaeda continues to offer the only support to the family.
People would find the situation you're in right now in Russia pretty terrifying. You obviously, you know, you heard what happened, what the treatment that Bradley Manning got, Chelsea Manning is now, is. And there was a story in BuzzFeed saying that there are people in the intelligence community who want you dead. How are you coping with this? How are you coping with the fear?
You know, it's no mystery that there are governments out there that want to see me. I've made clear again and again and again that I go to sleep every morning thinking about what I can do for the American people. I don't want to harm my government. I want to help my government.
صبيحة يوم الخميس الباردة كان الهدوء يعم المكان إلا من حركة دائبة لعدد من الأطباء والممرضين